So, I'm a real estate investor, and Glenn and I have known each other for 15 years. I think it was 2005, I was in the jam, and I was looking for opportunity, I was real hungry. And so we wound up at this organization, it was an MLM called National Land. I've only been in two MLMs my whole entire real estate entrepreneurial career, and they've both been around finance. So if you're gonna join an MLM, get in an MLM that's regarding finance. But we got into this opportunity originating loans, and I stayed here for 9 months, learned a lot of information, and I went out and started my own shop. What we did differently is that at the shop when we were at an NLC, we were originating loans for residential. When we left to start this company, it was my first business that actually was profitable, Business Consultants of America. We made our first $1 million in like 9 months after leaving that opportunity, because we made one decision, which was to originate loans for business owners. And actually, Tiffany was a big part of that. She actually watched me make $1 million. You know, and that was my first time, you know, making that kind of money. And like after that, different things started happening. While we were at Business Consultants at 260 P Street, and Tiff was in the, we created a credit restoration department. She actually handled the restoration of the credit. We created a protocol, created curriculum, the whole 9 yards, credit bible, we had all kinds of stuff going. During that time, there was so much money coming in the office. We were doing like $150,000 a month for a good 24, 36 months, something like that. It was nuts. So during that time, we started to learn about where to place the money, right? So during that time in Atlanta, if you needed some money, you would come to our shop. If you wanted to buy a plane, if you wanted to buy a subway, whatever the hell you wanted to get, we would put the deal together and finance this deal. So during that, a good 3 years that we were running, we ran for about 6 years, but the first three were great. I started to see where people started placing their funds, right? And so this is about the 2006, 2007, 8 time period. And everybody was in real estate. I mean, everybody was a real estate investor. But the problem that I saw people had was that they were using mortgages to do it, all right? So let's just air this out right here before we throw this presentation up. Matter of fact, you can get the slide right here. Yeah, which one was? Wealth protocols, here we go. So this is what we learned. And this is information that came out of Business Consultants of America. And honestly, people want to know how we learned all this stuff. It really came from that opportunity. Everything that I discuss, everything that I talk about with Black Economics, all of this stuff comes from what I learned at 260 Peachtree Street. The first order of business, if you're trying to be a real entrepreneur, is that you can't have any debt, number one. These are rules, right? I don't know if anybody told you this. Some of y'all might have been in college. Some of y'all look like y'all are real steady. Some of y'all might not have been in college. And actually, college has no bearing on your success, right? If the teacher really knew what was going on, the teacher wouldn't be teaching. And keep in mind, the teacher's teaching you dated information. It takes 7 years to create a protocol, a curriculum, 7 years to perfect curriculum. And the teacher teaches you a curriculum that took him 7 years to understand. In fact, it takes 2 years to print a curriculum through any major publishing clearinghouse. So you got about 10 years of dated information that you're taking loans out for to pay for. And when you get out into the real world, you can't even find a job to service the interest on those loans. So I'm not taking a shot at education, but what I'm telling you is that you want to know how to be an entrepreneur, you have to align yourself with real entrepreneurs that are doing real things, right? So this is what I learned for 10 years of loan brokering on a business hand. Number one, thou shalt not have a mortgage, right? And we listen to the etymology on the word mortgage. Mortgage in the Latin comes from the root morta fifth, and the Latin means death. The second word is engage. It's literally an engagement until death. When you go to look up the word mortgage, that's what it tells you, right? But y'all signed up for mortgage for 20, 30, 40 years. Your mom stays in the house for 40 years, pays it off 5 times, right? This is the protocol that's being shoved down our throat. And we accept this. We accept this as the truth, right? We're being told to go to school, get a good education so you can get a good job, right? And what do? We go out and get a student loan. Some of us stay in school for, I know Black folks don't just get in 4 years because we don't have our parents sitting here making sure that Johnny's going to class every day. It takes us 6, 7, 8 years to get out of a 4-year institution, right? And you're taking out loans, and what do? We take the loans out, and we go and we take the refund check, and we spend that up, right? So now we're behind the 8 ball, $200,000. So thou shalt not have a mortgage. Rule number one, if you want to play the real entrepreneur game, you cannot have a mortgage, right? Rule number two, you can't have any debt, meaning student loan. Student loan debt is a killer. Last year, the story hit on AJC, a lady who was 82 years old and she died. And they said, man, why did the lady die? They inquired, they were trying to figure out what was going on. They said that the lady next door said that she had an anxiety attack because the auto dialer kept calling her for student loan repayments. This was the narrative of why this woman died, 82 years old. How are you 82 years old and you still paying on student loan debt? Like, what's up with the amortization schedule on the student loan that the loan was still active to be collected on somebody that's 82 years old? That means that she went to school in, what, the 70s? That's 40 years on a debt schedule, man. Who's collecting on that? Like, we're not thinking this stuff through. Set the real estate investment conversation aside for a second. We're going to get to that. Before you can come up here and say, this is what I want to do, there's some things that have to happen. Number one, we can't have mortgages. Number two, we can't have student loans. Number three, we can't have car notes. Every car that I've ever driven since I met Glenn has been paid for. Every car. I got four Range Rovers, one of them's outside right now, all of them, I can show you the titles, all of them paid off, all right? I'm not trying to throw it in your face, I'm just telling you, in order to do what we get ready to do, you cannot have mortgages, you cannot have student loans, you cannot have car notes, all right? You're waiting for a transaction and it ain't moving as fast as you want to because of variable costs that Glenn has thrown out. You gotta have some kind of wherewithal or capacity to take you through that. You don't close every day. You know what I'm saying? A matter of fact, I just weathered, the last time I had a closing before these closings that just came up, I got a slew of closings, about like 15 closings in the next 3.5 weeks, right? But prior to that, I had to go 12 months. The last closing I had was on my birthday. I had a double closing last year on my birthday in February. And after that, I didn't close nothing until just 2 weeks ago before I went to Cairo. All right? What the hell do I got going on that I could weather an entire year without real estate income? We'll talk about that, right? So these three protocols, write this down. Thou shalt not have a mortgage. Thou shalt not have student loans, especially you young people, man. Because, you know, older folks, we gotta play catch up. We just now getting hip to this information. We just now being told this for the first time in life. Young people, you can gravitate to this, do this now, and put yourself in a position to actually build wealth. All these conversations that we have on Saturday mornings, these are wealth protocols. We can't really intentionally have these kinds of conversations. Why? Because we're carrying serious debt. Can't nobody talk about building wealth. Oh yeah, shout out, I want to make some money, Dr. Anderson. Well, are you in a position to? You're carrying debt. So we got to talk about debt elimination. No mortgage, no car note, no student loans. And here's the third thing, or fourth thing that's important. We have to generate positive cash flow. All right? And now what I'm talking to you about is not being a millionaire. Being a millionaire, we can show you how to be a real estate millionaire. I have a protocol today that I'm going to lay out that shows you step by step how to become a real estate millionaire. That's really not even the key. The key right now is what can you do to have positive cash flow? It can be between $1,000 and $10,000 a month. Just when you're starting out. Whatever that is, you can have a website, you can be selling t-shirts, you know, I have a speaking career, you know, that just started to blow up a couple of years ago. So now, you know, my average fee is like $5,000. I spoke 72 times last year. That's an additional $350,000 to $400,000 that came in that I just didn't even know anything about, right? So what am I getting to? We gotta have what's called multiple streams of income as entrepreneurs. That's cool. You say you generate income, positive cash flow. How do you do that? You have multiple streams of income. Now, some of y'all might be believers in the room. They say Solomon has 7 streams of income. The richest man to walk the planet was King Solomon. Now, net worth, it was Mansa Musa of Mali. Most of y'all might not know that. Mansa Musa is said has so much wealth that he, on his Hajj, on his pilgrimage to Mecca, broke economies. Because on his Hajj, going to Mecca, he dropped gold eggs that bankrupt the economy from Mali all the way up to Mecca. And that's actually what created the invasion to bring the slaves down to the new world, because they saw Mansa Musa flexing, flashing, with gold, dropping it, shining. That's what he was doing. It's in your DNA. Well, it's not that we are broke people. This is something that is not new to us. We have to just tap back into it and create that atmosphere. So here are the rules. No car note, no student loan, no mortgage. Generate positive cash flow. You do this by having multiple streams of income. It's okay to do more than one thing. It's okay. You're not all over the place. That's for the person who bought into the job. That's their reality. They're gonna stay there for 30, 40 years. And oh, they're gonna take their 401k and they're gonna hope that the corporate America gives it back to them. And they're gonna hope that it grows more than 5% over a 30-year period. Who does that? Nobody does that that's really trying to build wealth. Nobody does that. The only people that do that are common people. They play you every day and y'all don't even see it. You go to the bank, they give you a little sucker, right? A little candy. You say, that's what the bank do. They give you, you give them your money, they give you a what? They give you a sucker, right? The bank telling you how they feel about you. In fact, if you go deeper and actually look to see who created that sucker, the company's called Dum Dum. I'm saying, they're playing you all the way. Who does that? So somebody's in the back of the room laughing at y'all because you're out here buying into what's called the quote-unquote American dream, and what they're selling you, everything that they're selling you is wrong. Everything that they're selling you is to create a debt culture. Forget about racism and white supremacy. It's about being a slave to debt. And in the book, it states, you shall be the lender, not the borrower. How do our Jewish brothers and sisters, a country of only 7.2 million people, control all of the finances in the entire globe? How is that possible? What are they practicing? What are they doing? And every time you have to go to the film commission to put a film out, to pay $5,000 a screen, some of you might know I've invested in a few film documentaries, Black Friday, Generation One, Escaping the Corporate Plantation with Dr. Boyce Watkins, the Black Print that's coming out. How is it that each screen that you invest in, 2,000 screens, costs about $5,000? That's $20 million. The only conversation we should be having right now is how can we get some wealth? Not how can we get some money, how can we build some wealth? Period. Came here this morning by way of an invitation of a close friend to be able to show you guys how to do this, all right? I don't know everything, but I want to show you what's going on and we're going to get into this presentation. I think this might be in front of the speaker. So, every Tuesday for the past 10 years, we go to the courthouse steps in a number of jurisdictions. Fulton County, or excuse me, the state of Georgia has 159 counties, and we practice in a good 20 to 30 of them. What are you doing with your money? And I was like, man, at that time, I'm got planes at PDK waiting, the jets are running. I was like, man, I'm taking chicks to Milan, having breakfast, coming back home. Crazy, just doing stupid stuff. What are you doing with your money? He goes, Decker goes, you need to invest your money. And I says, well, I'm looking at tax lien certificates, right? It's 2007. I had just picked up Robert Kiyosaki's Rich Dad Poor Dad. So I got that book, got into the second protocol, which was Cash Flow Project. And in the second chapter, Kiyosaki stated that he did his first deal with him and his wife in Honolulu, Hawaii. And his first deal was a tax sale. And Kiyosaki never said nothing else about any of that in any of his books. So I had gotten wrapped up with this concept. I was like, man, if a man puts tax liens as his first opportunity and never writes anything about it, this must be the magic, the magic coin. So I started focusing on this energy on it, and it turned out that Mr. Decker was a master. It turned out that Mr. Decker had been practicing for 30 years, and he had been practicing law, and all of the commissions that he got on closing on these law deals, he was investing in tax liens. I never knew this. So he sits me down, he starts giving me some information, and from that point, on May 15, 2007, I started this process of investing in real estate tax liens certificates, and it's changed my life, right? Now, what I'm showing you here is a check. Brother, can you read this? This is from Fulton County. What does that say? How much is that for?
$9,000.
It's a check for $9,000. All right, cool. It's cool to the county, right? So we can authenticate this document. Does it say here the address of the property? Can you read that?
330 Winingworth Drive.
Okay. For some of y'all that came here, 330 Winding River Drive, Unit E. That's in where, class? Sandy Springs. Does anybody know where to buy a condo for $9,000 in Sandy Springs? Oh, I forgot to add, this don't have a mortgage on it. So a $150,000 asset, and so now you're engaged. Now you're like, oh, okay. This is a $150,000 asset, right, that we are cleaning out as we speak right now. Now, oh, Dr. Henderson, I thought you had to wait 12 months and 45 days with taxing certificates, and you showing us something that you just bought on Tuesday, and you telling me that the cleaning people are in there right now cleaning up, getting ready to listen on MLS tonight, and it's a $150,000 asset, right? That is the real estate game. If you're not able to find something for the Lolo, the Young Boys made a song about it. We get it for the Lolo. That's what they did, right? That's what they're talking about. I'm in love with the real estate. Yeah. I'm saying, if we're gonna do real estate, let's be real clear what real estate is. Real estate is the practice of buying it for the low and selling it what class? That's it. That's all we're trying to do. We're not trying to fix it up. We're not trying to rehab it. I know some of y'all are into the Reno game, and that's what y'all do. I'm not knocking that. But I'm talking the first-time entrepreneurs that are trying to build wealth, right? This is $150,000 potential value. Now, in order to get all that, I might have to put some money into it, but that's not what I do. I don't like doing that. I don't like working with my hands and breaking open walls and getting the mask on and getting the money. That's not me, right? I know I got $150,000 asset. I paid 10 G's for it, right? I'm gonna sell it for like $75,000, $85,000, $95,000. Let the next man come in here and do all that. That's a lot of work. I don't wear suits. I got on a scarf from Egypt. This is 100% handmade silk. I ain't trying to mess this up. Come on, man. Nah. Somebody said, Dr. Anderson, you bougie. It's okay to be bougie king. That's all right. You know what I'm saying? It's cool. You know what I'm saying? You know, own that. Accept that. So what I'm saying is y'all gotta pick your strategy. Y'all gotta know, you know, who you are and how your personality fits into what you do. If you know you're not really big on hospitality, don't get into the hospitality game. Don't buy a hotel if you know you can't deal with people. You understand what I'm saying? We gotta know our personalities. And we gotta figure out a way to operate in that space so that we can be successful. Taxing certificates is an opportunity to do that. Now, I don't wanna just get up here and sell y'all on the idea of tax liens and make y'all think that there's no downside to it. Let me show you the unsexy side of this. This right here, anybody know what these are? Y'all in the real estate, y'all know what these are? Anybody listen to Tupac in here? Pac put a song out called Checkout Time. Y'all remember that? It's Checkout Time. These are dispos. This is dispossessory. This means you've been in the house too long. And I got five of them that I just filed yesterday. It's checkout time, right? That means that we gotta own some kind of evictions company, right? It's called Room Squad Evictions, right? And we gotta hire them boys to go in here and clear it out, right? Bulletproof vests, you know, AR-15s, they call them sticks in the street, right? Street sweepers, right? We gotta go in there and take possession of the property. This is the type of stuff that has to go on. If you're not ready to do that, don't dream and, you know, what do they call, pontificate ad nauseum about real estate. Don't do it. Because if you're gonna be the landlord, you have to control your asset, maintain the asset. It takes force to do that, all right? So what am I getting to? If you're gonna play real estate game, there's some things that you need to know how to do. You gotta know or come up with a protocol that allows you to buy for the low low, right? Sell for the high high. You also have to have a way to protect your asset. You gotta have some kind of way to maintain and manage the asset while you're trying to get it to market and make sure the vandals don't come in here. And, you know, vandals like to go up under the house and strip out the copper and take out the HVAC unit, you know. You would think if you have all this knowledge of electricity, I mean, they climb up to the top of the pole 220 cycles and the current is going through the line. And these guys are climbing up the pole, no safety, nothing, no bucket truck, nothing. They disconnecting the line and rerouting it and connecting it to the house. If you got those kinds of skills, you need to be a master electrician with an electric company, you know, getting work, getting contracts. But you have to protect yourself from the advantage. The other part, if you're gonna play this game, which is really important, is you gotta be on your legal game. This is where entrepreneurs / real estate investors, this is where they fall off the wagon. Because you think about, oh, it's about finding a deal. It's not about finding a deal. And in fact, what they teach, you know you're getting misinformation, because when you go to the real estate commission, the real estate commission makes you pay for access to the MLS. And then they tell you, you gotta go to the MLS to find opportunity. Think about that. The MLS is the marketplace. This is where we go to bring our wares to market. This is where we charge a premium for what we're doing to unload our wares. Why are we gonna go to the market to try to find an opportunity? Come on, man, who does this? The only way you're gonna find real opportunity is off-market. We're all the off-market properties that are not on the market. Defeasible title via tax lien certificate. Or Dr. Anderson, what defeasible means? This is where this law game comes into play. And I'm not saying go to school and be an attorney, right? But you can take a class, you can take some CLE classes on quieting the title. How many people here know how to quiet a title? Show of hands, come on. Show of hands, one, two, three. How many people have actually gone through four? How many people have actually gone through the process of quieting title? One, two, okay. So this is where the game is. You wanna be a real estate investor, this is what you need to know. This right here is a quiet title action that just got signed off by the judge yesterday. All right? What I'm gonna show you is this. This is a whole other class right here. You can get into this for those of y'all that want to know this. I teach this just so that y'all know on a monthly basis for the last 10 years. Can you read to me the date when this was e-filed?
January 6th, 2017.
January 6th, 2017. And just read the language right here. The motion, the petition.
Petition to quiet title pursuant to the OCGA.
The code. Alright, so this is a basic petition, right? Petition in the court to be able to quiet the title. What you need to know about quieting the title is that you're shutting everything down. All clouds to titles are getting shut down and set aside is what's called in court. This is the motion for default judgment and final order. Can you read the date on when that was e-filed?
March 29th.
So listen, we started the action when? January, right? We just got the motion for default judgment. I got the final order too, but this is the motion for default judgment signed by the judge on the 29th of March. The judge signed off on it yesterday, April 6th. How long did it take me to shut down? And who did we shut down, class? You gotta read this, it's the most important part. Read this here. The tenant, Harvey, okay, Sherrilland, the mortgage electronic registration system. Anybody know who that is? MERS. Who's this? Taylor Bean Whitaker Mortgage Company. Anybody know about Taylor Bean and Whitaker? They have to sit down. Who's this? Regional Medical Group, PNC Bank, National City Bank, Riot Capital. All of them banks have to sit down. Do you understand this? This is the game. Cats is running out here telling y'all, selling y'all on stuff on the side of the corners, man, with bullhorns and stuff, doing go-lives, telling you they know how to do real estate, selling you on the wholesale game. This is how you do real estate, man. You ain't doing real estate if you ain't setting banks aside. That's the game.
Yes.
Ain't nobody teaching that. They take your money, they take your $15,000 and you ain't teaching me how to set a bank aside for 15 G's? Come on, man. I can't talk to you about my ideas in real estate. I gotta pay you 10, 20, 30 G's and you ain't teaching this? They robbing y'all blind. And cause y'all have limited information, you giving it up. So there's some wealth protocols to this, man. And if you ain't on your legal game, if you can't do that right there, you ain't playing real estate the right way. I ain't saying what you're doing is wrong. We all gotta get somewhere. We all gotta start wholesaling. We all gotta start flipping houses, doing whatever we're doing. But when I was a child, I acted as a child. When I grew up as a man, I do what gentlemen do. Gentlemen don't play that game. Mr. Decker was real clear on how he was practicing law for 40 years on what to do. And he didn't have to tell me that information. This dude is an established gentleman in Georgia practicing law for 30 years. He had no business even talking to me. He decided to share some game. It was a choice. And at that time, I listened. And this is what I found out I'm sharing with y'all. Y'all want to be real estate investors? Get on your legal game. You don't got to go back to law school. You ain't got to go to Georgia State School of Business and learn all these different aspects of family law and all this bankruptcy law. You need to understand something real specific, which is real estate investing, more specifically tax sales, and the code on how to quiet titles. You know how to quiet titles, you know how to find deals, and you know how to go raise money. Yo, you got a skill set for life, man. You unstoppable. You like Superman. So don't nobody gotta run around and say, hey, come over here, I got all the answers. Nah, you can just be quiet, doing what you do, teaching your little class, and when people figure it out, then they show up, they pay your fee, you keep That's how it goes. Let's get into this. So we talked about wealth protocols, all right? And I have documentation on my stuff. I'm gonna remind me to show you all this right here before we get out of here. Grandma got 20 G's left from a $500,000 portfolio. People outside of our community, what they go buy hotels, right? And then they make granddad or whoever got it, they make a whole parlor room and they put a bus there and they say, this is granddad's room. I'm serious. This is how we gotta start moving. We can't move like how we've been moving because it's killing us. So self-finance strategy, this is what I believe in real entrepreneurship. I've never had, God has blessed us to have information, so I've never had to take out a loan and start any business that we've ever started. I had three, now four major runs in entrepreneurship in the last 10, 15 years. And I didn't have to take out a loan to make it. So with that being the case, self-finance strategies are extremely powerful for entrepreneurs. Now a lot of this stuff was done, some of y'all might not know, I'm the founder of the Empowerment Radio Network. This is the nation's only 100% wholly owned African American owned talk radio network. Right? So I'm extremely proud of that because it gives us an ability to have a control of narrative. We don't play any music, we don't play Beyonce and Jay-Z. All we deal with is information on it. I financed a few films, bought a laundromat that was on the Blind Side, if y'all seen the Blind Side, with Sandra Tedford, won an Oscar. The laundromat that they were filming, that was my place at the time. So I've done some amazing things in Atlanta. But how I've been able to do these things with tax incentives. So what I'm getting to is, if you make a little bit of change, you do $100,000, you go to the sale, and you buy 10 or 20 liens, that means you up $1 million. I'm gonna show y'all how to do this today, all right? So it might not be $1 million in cash, but it'll be $1 million in assets. So if you got a safe, a fireproof safe with some, you know, 100 deeds in the safe, you're good. Ain't nobody coming at you talking about, this is a problem. This is a problem because you think it's a problem. It ain't a problem for me. Because all I gotta do is go in the safe with someone on the market and wait for it to sell. That's a self-finance strategy. Think about how powerful that is. So I said, oh, we went to Egypt. Now, the Egyptian government wants us to finance something called chematology, right? What is chematology? Chematology is basically gonna be us filming Dr. Anthony Barber's findings in these tombs. And he's excavating 25th dynasty stuff. BBC ain't covering it. CNN ain't covering this. They talking about what's going on in Syria because Trump don't want to own up to the fact that he's doing business with Russia. They playing y'all. Ain't nobody talking about these findings in the Valley of the Kings, in Luxor. So when we get there, the Egyptian government knows we in town. They're like, oh man, we want y'all to come here and cover this. Now, I can't go to the bank and be like, okay, we need 150 G's to go and shoot this thing at the end of the year. I gotta have that money right now to send my film crew over there. Right? How does that happen? Oh, you want to shoot a new movie. Waiting for the closing. Winding River Drive. As soon as it closes, that's another $85,000. I think that'll cover the film costs. Can the Luxorian government, can the Egyptian government give us some money? Give us, comp us some flights on Egypt there? Put us up in some hotels? Oh, sure, of course. Now I might not even have to pay anything. Because we coming across the table as if the capacity is there. And they're wanting the story to get out because their tourism and traveling went from 15 million to 5,000. So of course they want exposure on what's going on to get people to come and travel to Egypt with everything that's going on in Syria and all this stuff. They losing money. They gotta figure something out. They don't have a choice. So now we're getting governments to pay us to shoot films about what's going on in their country. This would have never happened if we didn't have the capacity to pull from the safe, put stuff on the market and have something going on. You don't gotta have millions of dollars, but you gotta at least have $50,000 to $100,000 to figure something out. $50,000 to $100,000 will change your life. So we're talking benefits and tax incentives, right? This is self-finance strategy. I just gave you a self-finance strategy on how you can do that, all right? I gotta work this out. Okay, first time home buyer strategy. This is really important, especially for the young brothers that are in here. So listen, let's just keep it all the way 100. And I'm not on Facebook and streaming, and I don't want to alienate anybody. I don't want people to feel like, oh, Dr. Henderson is just pro-black man and all this type of stuff. No, listen, right? The reason why black men are in the position that they're in, because we don't move from a position of strength, ever. No, you could. We don't ever move from a position of strength. We always move from backpedaling, well, your honor, well, sir. We can't move like that. All right, what if I told you that when you go to buy your first house, you should go on the tax lien list and look for a $9,000 property? Everybody put their hands on 10 G's, You go ask your mom for 10 G's, okay? Everybody can do this. What if instead of you going out here trying to buy a house, getting a mortgage, you went out there and looted, right? And you bought a house for 10 G's. What would your mom say? How would she handle you? If you was like, mama, look, I just bought this house, I got a warranty deed. How would she respond to that?
It's a whole different ballgame.
She lose her mind, right? Imagine, now let's sit that aside for a second. Imagine if all men move like that. Imagine if we gave, if fathers told men that in the rites of passage, you ain't a man until you come in this house with a warranty deed. You don't get to be no man. Because real men own. Real people don't rent. Are you serious? Who does that? You can rent for a short amount of time, but you're not to be a tenant. In the Jewish benevolent law, in the Torah, it says that to be a tenant is an abomination. This is their religion. But y'all going to church every weekend, giving up the tithe, listening to the pastor. The pastor's not telling you what the deal is. It's in the book. To be a tenant is an abomination in the Jewish religion. Look it up. But we being told to rent. That's not a protocol for wealth building. That ain't even a protocol for manhood. So imagine if we use tax lien certificates to be able to lay down protocols for first-time homebuyers. Just for men, so men can be men. Oh, I had a baby with my baby mama too. What does it matter? Your house that you own free and clear was within a 10-mile radius of the kid's school. You can pick them up every day. In fact, you can go get full custody. I know this for a fact. You go into Fulton County and you got ownership title to your house, who getting your kid? It might take you somebody to argue it because they don't really see that a whole lot. But if you're aggressive about it, you hire the right attorneys and you show that you got the wherewithal and capacity, you're taking the kids out of whatever situation that they're in. Alright? So these are real protocols for real life, man. This ain't just about making money, man. This is about establishing ourselves so that we can really come into the greatness that we're in. We having these problems right now because we don't know who we are, man. We acting like we plebeians. That's worse than peasant. That's a lower form in the caste system. The plebeian, that's worse than the peasant. So we gotta gravitate to these protocols, man, so that we know what's going on. Education strategy. Y'all can go to YouTube, because some of y'all might not be familiar with my career. Type in Dr. David Anderson. It's over 200 videos. One of them videos on YouTube is my son, David Anderson Jr. You can Google this. David Jr. goes to school in Vermont. He goes to a school called Middlebury in Vermont, all right? David Jr. speaks three languages, okay? Middlebury is like a language school, and they do a little bit of business. So he was trying to get into the top nine Ivies, and he got second interviews with all of them. Yale, Dartmouth, Harvard, all of that. And he got second interviews on all of them and didn't get in. Alright? So my dad went to Harvard and he had taught there in the Divinity School for some years. My dad got involved and he was like, David Jr. ain't gonna make it into the Ivies, the nine Ivies. You need to get him in a sub-Ivy like Middlebury. I was like, nah, Dad, we're gonna get this. He gonna do what you did. My father was like, no, he need to go and apply to Middlebury. So I let my dad get involved. My dad puts the application together or whatever, and he winds up getting into Middlebury and getting a $50,000 scholarship. Now, if you Google Middlebury, it's in Vermont, Middlebury, Vermont. The school's $75,000 a year. Harvard is $62,500 a year. This school's more than Harvard University. They gave him 50 G's, that's all cool, but now we got another 25 on the table, and he might take 5-6 years, knowing my son. Because he want to travel, he want to go to Japan, he want to hang out, you know, konnichiwa, watashi no nana wa den nasu nesu nashimasu. What's up, y'all? How y'all doing? Japanese. You know, so he's gonna go over there and do some different stuff. So I'm like, okay, so this $150,000 and I gotta put on tickets. I done talk all this junk on Facebook, I'm in movies, right? I'm talking all this trash. We ain't using student loan. So here come my number come up, right? Number come up, we gotta pay the school bill. So I did the, he got accepted in February. They have this thing called FedMaster for some of these bougie schools, right? So he got accepted for the February last year. And so the deal that I did last year, the double deal that I did, the double closing that I had, I made enough money after I paid my partners to send that money up to TD Bank in Vermont for the whole year. The whole year. The kid from Atlanta, from Southwest ATL, Charlotte, is up in Vermont at the language school, living in a Japanese house, speaking three different languages, and His bill is clear. Matter of fact, they just sent the bill down for this year. The bill just came to the PO box. And as soon as I'm done with what I'm doing, next week sometime, I can go and send TD Bank the other portion of the funds for his semester for this year, for the whole year, no student loans. Right? I'm not trying to show up, I'm trying to give y'all protocols for how you handle life issues. Okay? Nobody's telling us this. You get to the financial aid line, they're telling you, well, we have information on Pell, we have direct loans, and we need you to co-sign for your son. Nobody co-signing nothing. Come on, think about this, man. This is where they're trapping y'all. And because, you know, you got issues with credit and all this other stuff. Oh, well, I can't apply. Who's using credit? Credit is the most racist form of notating where you are as an individual on the planet. And you don't even know it. And people who live in 303 10 zip will never have a good credit score. I don't care if you got Payne's degree for 40 years, your credit score will always be in the low 60s. Because they value your zip code based off of where you are. That means that if you live in the West End, you need to go get a P.O. box somewhere in Alpharetta, exit 10, Mansell Road. In order for you to get the 720 that you deserve. But ain't nobody telling you this because ain't nobody in the finance game like this. We sitting here arguing about things that are affecting us and how we feel and our emotions. We want to go march, we want to put our fists in the air. That has nothing to do with nothing. Don't want to stop people from putting 5 or 10 bullets in your back. Get some insurance. Every black man in here had Keyman life insurance for $10 million. See how fast them folks stop shooting y'all. It'll be an edict from the Trump administration. Telling y'all, do not shoot black people. Because we got to pay off on insurance $10 million. We're bankrupt the insurance game, man. Think about this, man. Y'all not serious about stopping this stuff. Y'all want to stop people from coming in your community and killing y'all? Own some land. When you pay for real estate taxes, guess where your money goes? It goes towards education and law enforcement, man. Law enforcement don't come at me crazy. I just told y'all we filed 5 different evictions. Dr. Anderson, what are we doing today? Hey, man, if you don't pay, you can't stay. That's right. We're getting them out. Ain't nobody coming at me talking about put your hands in the air. We don't win. You can't come at me like that. Come out here and play the real estate game, and y'all not vacationing. I ain't even open my mouth, taking my coat off yet. Lady talking about, hey, you was in Egypt. We on Facebook doing videos on a camel. With my daughter, we ride a camel to go to the Great Pyramids in a desert. And I'm sitting here talking about real estate investing. Yep, the camel going up and down. I'm like, yeah, this is why y'all need to learn how to be real estate investors. Because we in the desert, and she's supposed to be in school right now. Call me, all right? Text us, 700.com. I'm a holler back. Y'all not traveling enough. Negroes don't even have passports. Come on, man. You gonna play hard and you ain't gonna travel? Who does this? Oh, well, Dr. Anderson, the tickets are too expensive. Listen, if you're making money, you can find one of them Delta chicks or one of them people that work for United and get them $2,000-$3,000 and have them miss you as a life partner. And you can go wherever. Come on, man. I've been somebody's life partner for 5 years. In fact, she saw me on the camera and was like, yo, man, you gotta give me 3 G's. She sent me a baby out. She was like, I went on the first. So she having all this fun. You know what I'm saying? We gotta go out and see the world, man. The opportunity to see the world is closing. And if you don't do what you need to do now and get a passport now and start traveling and start doing business globally, you're gonna be relegated to what's going on in this country, man. And what's going on in this country is coming to a close. America is a wrap. That's a political conversation. I'm gonna stay focused on this real estate, man. What I'm trying to get to y'all is to understand that you can use, we're talking benefits and tax gain certificates, right? You can use this strategy to buy vacation homes. Let me expound. Decker told me that tax gain certificates are not just good in Fulton County in Georgia. They're good all over the United States of America. Even in other U.S. jurisdictions. Class, what are the U.S. jurisdictions? Puerto Rico. We'll talk about that. Set Puerto Rico aside just for a second. We got U.S. Virgin Islands, St. Croix, St. Thomas, St. John's, Guam, what is it? Solomon Islands, Hawaii, but ain't nobody buying no taxes out there, too far. And Puerto Rico. Why is the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico so important, class? Economy? All right, now we get into the real. This is why you come to Real Life Real Estate Investing, to get information from real real estate investors that are gonna break down protocols like this. Everybody tonight, you can go to Google and type in Puerto Rican Act 2021. Why is this important? The United States Tax Code, Section 933, states that every business and or LLC files 1120 and or 1120S, except Puerto Rico. Did you understand what I just said there?
Yeah.
Okay, right. Because most real estate investors, so far real estate investors, don't know it. They're not making enough money to have to figure out tax advantage strategies so they don't have to pay 4% or 37% on the federal level. So ain't nobody doing this right here. Section 933 states that if your business is based in Puerto Rico, in the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, you don't have to pay federal taxes.
Wow.
That's in the code. This ain't no new lobbying strategy trying to go get your straw man back in 51 books. This is United States tax code, man. So somebody tell me, why is Wesley Snipes in jail for tax evasion? Why is that? Because he claimed sovereign man, and he said he was the indigenous brother. He traced his roots back to Sacagawea, and Sacagawea crossed over with Lewis and Clark on the Lewis and Clark expedition, and so he was owners to that Louisiana Purchase deal. Come on, man, the judge ain't trying to hear that. Go sit down before you even sit on Wesley. That's an esoteric argument. Oh, well, we claiming, what we claim, what they call that stuff? Sovereign man? We claiming sovereign man, Dr. Anderson. Dr. Malachi York, come on, man. I'm not knocking on what I'm saying is, in the court of law, they not trying to hear that. They got Lauryn Hill on that at JFK Airport, coming back from Jamaica. Water in, they cuffs. The judge asked her, hey, Lauryn, what's going on? $980,000 unpaid, last 10 years. $137,000 a year on back royalties from my favorite song. The judge even put it on the table. Miseducation, Lauryn Hill. I hate that you're in front of my courtroom. I study this, man. I get them judge notes. They made her do some time. Ron Isley, this is on YouTube. Ron Isley is in the orange, man. An orange jumpsuit singing Golden Lady to the Water in Elmira, New York. Come on, y'all, this is tax evasion. Somebody say, oh, it's racism. Is it? Or is it that these Negroes that are making all this money ain't getting the counsel to know that if they basically bought a tax lien certificate in Puerto Rico, which has a 6-month right to redemption, they can establish residency in the Commonwealth. And if they open up a bank account in the Bank of Puerto Rico and did all their deals from the closing table, go straight to the Bank of Puerto Rico, then they would be admonished from having to charge a federal tax bracket, meaning they wouldn't have to pay federal taxes. Now, let me say this, because we got cameras rolling. You gotta spend some time in Puerto Rico, like 190 to 180 days, so you might need to own a plane so you can fly down there on the weekends and hang out so you can actually, you know, fall in line with the guidelines. But Ron Isley, Lauryn Hill, and Wesley Snipes can handle a little King Air, right? 2000 King Air with extended fuel tanks on there, and jet back and forth. Hell, you can get a Hawker. Hawker only like $2 million with some Rolls Royce engines. Engines is like $1 million each. The planes are $500,000, so they're all over the plane. $2.5 million, you go on the jet. You ain't got $2.5 million? Come on. This Wesley's nice. Come on, Wesley. So what am I saying? I'm saying we gotta know real information. Cats is out here pushing halfway information, limited information. Ain't nobody giving y'all a whole picture on what's really going on. And how do you know about this? Because in San Juan every year, they have a Puerto Rican Investment Summit. Anybody writing that down? You can Google that. You want to know more about that, you go to the summit. You go get on the plane and go to the Puerto Rican Investment Act Summit and go deal with the cats that are in tax lien certificates that are all based in Puerto Rico. Ain't nobody that's really in real estate not based in Puerto Rico.
Oh, I'm in Delaware, I'm in Wyoming, I'm in Nevada.
All right, cool, keep playing that game. $1,000 to expedite in Nevada to do a name change. Who does that, man? Limited people who got limited information and think they know. Let's talk about this. Because some of y'all walked in here without no goals in real estate. I'm going to give you a whole bunch. This is one of the most important. This is called an accredited investor strategy. Now, September 4th, 2007. What's up, Giovanni? September 4th. This is a young man that I'm mentoring. I called him on the way up here and told him to come through because I wanted him to learn. He got some CDs and stuff going to sell in the back. He stopped what he was doing, put a suit on, got cleaned up, and got in the car and came on. On a side note, for all you brothers that's up here, if y'all not mentoring other young cats, they don't got to be your kids. If you're not just taking somebody and mentoring them and giving them this information, then you a suck. Straight up, I'm going to tell you to your face. If you ain't doing that, that's about your father's business up here. So, you know, you can't be out here doing real estate and doing it by yourself. You got to have other people that you're transferring this information to. We all got limited time on the planet. And so your legacy is not going to be how much money you made. Your legacy is going to be how many other young people that you brought with you. Because these are the people that hold you down. When you get sick, you can't, you out of town, you can't do stuff. You call them on the phone, FaceTime, and be like, yo, I need this done, and they do it. Alright? Anyway, that's just a side note. Let's talk about this accredited investor strategy. This has to be one of the most powerful strategies in entrepreneurship. Alright? Why is that? On September 4th, 2007, I bought my first real estate investment property. I bought a property in the hood, 1930 Honeysuckle Lane, in the hood, in the track, what they call it. Alright? And after 10 years of doing this, I had a conversation with an FA at a particular institution, and the FA was looking through my assets. Now, when the banks or the financial institutions, when you get ready to invest some money, they gotta quantify it. They gotta see, you know, what you got. Even when you go to the bank to get a loan, they say, well, what you got? Most people say, well, I got my house. Now, in the world of financial institutions, they don't count the house as net worth requirement. The house, the primary residence ain't even on the sheet, all right? So I came in there with a shoebox of deeds. I had like 27 deeds that I put them on the table. And the dude was like, we need to take some more time and go through this, get the appraisals on each property. These houses are coming in about $50,000 to maybe $100,000 each. And you got 27 of them. You're probably in the accredited investor status area. I'm like, dude, accredited investor, what you talking about, man? What the accredited investor is? I'm like, what you talking about, man? So he goes, well, the accredited investor gives you opportunities or access of an abundance. You know, gets you on the DMV list, and the DMV list puts you in the high net worth category. You get different information that you're subscribing to. I'm like, really? Yeah, you know, you get on the high net worth list. They call you all the time with real opportunities. I was like, man, this is crazy. So we go through the process, right? Quantifying the net worth requirement to be able to become an accredited investor. Why is this important? This is important because, I don't know if you remember this, when Michael Hill called the office one day, I don't know if you were in the office. Michael Hill is the president of the Chamber of Commerce here in Atlanta, one of them, Georgia Chamber of Commerce. And he called one day and he was like, my office was across the street from the Hyatt, 265. He said, yo, the FDIC is having a fire sale. You need to get over there. I was like, man. Meaning the FDIC, when banks collapse, the FDIC steps in, puts them in receivership, and they have these fire sales. Y'all want to make some money, go to FDIC.gov and look on the website and look up next fire sales or independent bank sales, right? He's like, man, the banks are selling. So I go run across the street, I take a lunch, I go across the street from the office, I go to this fire sale, this Federal Deposit Insurance Company fire sale. And the gentleman at the front is like, good evening or good afternoon. He said, do you have a ticket? And I'm like, no, I ain't got a ticket. He's like, oh, well, you have to be an accredited investor to enter and be able to bid and meet your power. And I'm like, oh, well, how do I go about determining if I'm an accredited investor? Well, you would have to have a letter of determination status from a respectable institution, and your financial advisor would need to have faxed it over at this point. I'm like, all right, cool. Let me get on the horn right quick, excuse me. Jubal Gatwood, please, Morgan Stanley. Yeah, hey, listen, I need you to fax something over. Can you get the fax? Oh, sure, there ain't no problem. What's the fax number? So this, oh, I'll never forget this. This old black lady was in the back, and she just was like. And she ran right to the fax machine. She was like, so at the time, I'm like, yeah, Jubal, what's the fax number? She's giving me the number. 404-527. I'm like, yeah. What's in the safe deposit box? Gold bullion, gold coins, keys, deeds, deeds to boats, deeds to planes, deeds to houses, deeds to real estate. All this stuff was in the box. And people had bidding $100. I was like, yo, this is nuts. I've never seen nothing like this, right? But the only reason why I gained access class is why? And why did I gain access? Because I was a credit investor. Because I happened to go OD on debt certificates, right? So these are protocols to wealth building. If you continue and be diligent and build your portfolio, you can be an accredited investor. It gives you access to different types of information. Did you know that Uber's getting ready to go public? Anybody know that? Uber third quarter this year getting ready to go public. They say it's the number one startup in the country. Bigger than Facebook. This is Uber, right? Ain't nobody making no money on Uber by the time it hit. You gotta get in prior to. Anybody know who the private client wealth management is that's handling that? Oh man, come on, it's JP Morgan. Anybody know what the initial investment is? Come on, this is why you gotta be, this is why you gotta be a credit investor. We sitting here worrying about what's going on with TMZ, Jay-Z, Beyonce, did Solange kick this dude in the chest, what's going on? We worrying about the wrong thing. We need to be focused on becoming accredited investors, because when Uber goes public, if y'all can get in on the back end, $500,000 or pool stuff, resources together, $1 million, $5 million, whatever, when that joint hits, you're gonna be a billionaire or multimillionaires. Think about it. When Facebook hit, Mark Zuckerberg controlled 90% of the stock. 86%. Peter Thiel had 10%, because he made a $500,000 investment, Peter Thiel, SpaceX, PayPal, Peter Thiel. And Eduardo Saverin from Sao Paulo gave 20 G's when they was in Harvard. He had a 4.5% interest in Facebook. Does anybody know what the Facebook valuation was when it came to market? It was like $8 billion. Peter Thiel immediately wanted all his money in cash the next day. He said, Zuckerberg, why am I $800 million here? Because he's trying to put planes in outer space. Eduardo Saverin made so much money, he renounced his United States citizenship and became a Singaporean. Zuckerberg did the same thing. He even married a Singaporean 2 weeks before the stock became public and renounced U.S. citizenship and is a resident of Singapore.
Wow.
And he didn't go to jail. But Wesley Snipes, Ron Isley, and Lauryn Hill all did federal time. Is it racism or is it information? There it is. Let's talk about becoming a real estate millionaire. I told y'all I was gonna do this. Norfolk, Virginia, earlier this year, we had a screening of a film called Black Friday that I was one of the executive producers of. David Banner, George Frazier, Michael B. Roberts, Cynthia Bailey, like there's a lot of people that's in this movie. And the narrative is, what do we gotta do to be able to get ourselves out of knowledge, right? In a better position. And I had, the year just started, and I had these late night conversations, people calling, talking about, oh, we can't pay the money to the funeral home director, can you help us out? They got the body on hostage. Could you imagine your mama died, right? And they don't want to, the funeral home director, which I understand, don't want to release the body for the showing because Negroes don't got burial insurance or y'all don't got whatever y'all need. So you know what happens. We got to do crowdfunding. We got to do go lives on scoop stuff. We don't have insurance properly put in place. So I have made mention to this comment that we need to do a better job of insuring ourselves, you know, like even going to the extent of over insuring. And it just so happened that there was a young lady in the crowd whose father died, and the father was a major real estate investor and had taught her real estate her whole life, and you know, the policy paid out a certain amount of money that she had access to, and she didn't know what to do with it. And so I gave this example, what I'm about to give to y'all, and she moved on it. And I don't know if some of y'all are friends with me on Facebook, but there was a photo that started to circulate with a sister in front of an entire commercial complex in Sandy Springs in Alpharetta that was worth $750,000. That she bought for $7,000. And this is her portfolio. I got the deed right here. Right? So what am I saying? I'm saying everybody can't do this because we work with our clients in two ways, right? We have a wealth strategy where if a client has access to that kind of money, and it's nothing major. I mean, policies usually pay out between $250,000 and $500,000. So if there's a policy that's been paid out at $500,000, you know, it's not uncommon to put $100,000 in tax lien certificates. And why is that? Tax lien certificates are guaranteed principal plus interest to the tune of 20%. So if you put your $100,000 in the bank's only gonna give you like 3 2-3% on that money, unless it's in emerging markets or something like that. All right? Whereas with tax lien certificates, if you put that money in the ground, the municipality guarantees 20%, and in Georgia, you can get up to 30%, depending on the situation. So this is the actual deed. The long and the short is, she saw the film, she got inspired, she came to Atlanta, took the class, she wound up putting up 100 G's of payout money from her daddy's policy, and this is the actual deed right here. Brother, can you read this for me? 960, you can read that?
Holcomb Bridge.
Come on, guys.
960 Holcomb Bridge, bro.
Now, anybody know what Holcomb Bridge is?
Yeah.
Nope.
Okay. How much did she pay for that?
$7,286.42.
And this is the deed right here. This is the stamp, this is received, stamp file with the clerk and everything. That's live action right here. Alright? And class, there's 10 more of these deeds that she bought. I got them in my hand right here. This is this property, after we sat down and evaluated it, from a $100,000 investment, because I had to take my commission out of here, and then I spent about $85,000 minus my commission. On an $85,000 investment, that portfolio right now is worth $1.5 million. All she got to do is sit back. She's already 6 months into it. All she got to do is sit back, and in October, November of next year, we're going to start the process of clearing the title, which we know we can do, because we just did that in less than 90 days, and then go in the market. So in another 9 to 12 months, she's gonna be worth $1.5 million liquid, not just asset-based, but liquid. We're talking protocols and benefits to tax lien certificate investing, all right? If y'all can't, anybody wanna be a real estate millionaire?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Everybody in the room, if you're not already, you should wanna be a real estate millionaire. And let's get to the mechanics of it. Hopefully I've given you enough information to spark your interest in what we're talking about. Let's give you some scenarios. We call this the no mortgage strategy. And for some of y'all that might not be able to do training and all this other type of stuff that we got going on, or group coaching, we have tools. I got audio books, 5-hour audio books, that normally online and stuff's $100 a book. I'm gonna do it for $49.99 after the class is over, just because it might be some people who wanna know more, right? And we have an extended amount of information that we're not gonna be able to get done with in class setting like this. But this is the average purchase price that I recommend. It should be between $1,000 and $10,000, right? We know that because I just showed y'all a deed earlier for the deal in Winding River. We spent $9,000, all right? So that's proving that, okay? So using the no mortgage strategy, the average appraised value of the real estate we find is somewhere between $70,000, $75,000, and $150,000, all right? So somewhere in between that, if you do that 10 times, you're looking at accredited investor status, and if you go to Google and ask what do you need, what is the requirement for accredited investor, which I didn't talk about, I'll just say this right quick. The requirement is two things. Either one, you have a net income of $200,000 or more, right? And nobody does that. Okay, I don't know if you looked at Warren Buffett's tax return, but Warren Buffett's executive administrative assistant, filed a return for $175,000. Warren Buffett filed his return for $150,000. So what I'm saying is, the Securities Exchange Commission says that $200,000 is what determines a high net worth individual, and Warren Buffett don't even file a tax return for $200,000, then nobody in this room should be filing a tax return for over $150,000. Are you following?
Right.
All right. The second way that you become an SEC accredited investor is to have access to $1 million in net worth. That means there's a corporation or LLC, and there's 10 to 20 tax liens attached to that, and now, ta-da, you're a real estate millionaire. That's not pie in the sky. That's not me with a bullhorn doing a go live on the side of the road. That's really what it is right there. That's straight cut, no chasing. So, I told you about my first deal, September 4th, 2007, where I purchased this house for $4,700 or something like that. It was about $5,000 more than taxes, right? And this particular property changed my life. And the reason why is because there's a couple of things going on at that time in my life. I was fighting for the right to have access to my children. So a whole kind of craziness going on. But one thing that happened was we started this program. I did a radio show at the time called Black Anonymous on Sirius XM, early Saturday morning. And I started that radio show in the closet of this townhouse on Council Road. So for some of y'all that know, as the founder of the Empowered Radio Network, the nation's only 100% wholly owned Black Talk Radio Network, the genesis of Empowered Radio started because of a tax haven. We're talking Ben Smith on WALK CBS Radio, Rashad Richie, who we syndicated, Warren Valentine, all these people happened because I bought a tax lien September 4th, 2007. Because being able to produce that show once a week to XM Radio consistently for 7 years allowed me the opportunity to put more of the talent on my network, which created the opportunity for Empowered Radio. What I'm saying is, if you give yourself stability, you can do whatever the hell you want to do. If you're stable. If you know, okay, I gotta run back to my mama house because I got big ideas and I'm trying to figure them out and I got all the tools and resources to do. Sometimes you can have big ideas, all you need is an anchor. A lot of entrepreneurs fail because they don't understand this concept and they don't give themselves what they need to be successful. Let's talk about this transaction. I paid about $5,000 for it. If I was to rent it out right now, it's a full rehab. Jay's got to it. I've been out of it for about 7 years. Jay's the worn out. But if I were to fix it up, I'd probably get somewhere between $650 and $850 a month for it. All right? Either way, it's still a property that I own, I hold title to, and its appraised value is $82,500. The second transaction that I did, the purchase price was $6,800. And this particular property sits on the Beltline. A lot of y'all might not know about the Beltline. The Beltline in the Atlanta proper area caused the value to go up $216,000, and there's no structure on it. That's just for the land. It's down the street from the dome. It's right in the tax allocation district. It's nuts, right? So just in the first two properties, those first two acquisitions, my net worth went up $300,000 on day one. Think about that. People that's dealing with divorce, those other things, they're mad, they don't want to give land up, you can just do some transactions and be done with it. Let me give you this and then we're going to take some questions. Here's a sample tax strategy. This is the strategy that we gave to Ms. Tiffany Dirk. We've got four or five clients that have done this. If you purchase one property a month for 12 months, which is a pretty aggressive strategy, you're looking at having a portfolio somewhere between 10 and 12 properties. You're looking at average equity between $75,000 and $150,000, and a portfolio value of between $900 and $1.8 million. And we just proved that with the Tiffany Durham portfolio here, right? I can go on and on about how to exit out of this. This is a tenant locating process if you need to exit out of here. But this is enclosed, what's important. We're not going to learn what it took me to learn in 15 years in an hour and a half session on Saturday. Right? So this is a commitment, this is a process. Me, Glenn, Tiffany went through something that caused us to commit to the finance game, more specifically real estate 15 years ago. Alright? So what I'm getting to is in your travels as entrepreneurs, you gotta commit. Right? You're not gonna do this overnight. This is a commitment to information. So if you're interested, I've got products right now because of the relationship with Glenn, we're gonna discount that, so that's $49 for the products, but this is what's important. We got two programs, and then I'm gonna shut it down. We have a judicial foreclosure program, which we talked about. Judicial foreclosures can get done in 30 days or less, the acquisition part of it, all right? Meaning, because it's not an actual tax lien, you don't have to fall up under the guise, the code says 12 months and 45 days. So what is this, judicial foreclosures? These are HOA liens, which is what this deal is here. Somebody paid the house off, but didn't pay the HOA. Okay? So we bought the HOA lien and foreclosed on it, and now we own the house free and clear. And we bring it to market, we're about to make it. After we pay everybody about 8 inches, cool $80,000. Easy money. All right? So judicial foreclosures, you're talking HOA liens, you're talking super tax liens. We didn't get a chance to talk about that because we're out of time. Super tax liens are really, really crazy. All right? That's a whole other class. But these are all of the instruments that you can acquire in 30 days or less, all right? How long it takes you to go to market, you can ask the client for 12 months, but it can get done somewhere between 90 and 120 days, all right? We offer training, the retainer is $5,000, minimum investment that we ask for is like 20 G's, the potential ROI between $25,000 and $50,000. So for instance, in this deal here, this apartment we already shot, the retainer for this is $15,000. This is what Tiffany did. All right, so she retained us for a whole year. She put up $100,000. Potential ROI, as you can see right here, is between $1.5 and $1.8 million. All right, but it takes the timeline of this is somewhere between 12 and 24 months. So if you got some cash from a policy or a payout, grandma died or something like that, and you want to put it to work, you just don't want to keep it at Smith Barney and let them play with your money during the Trump administration, or you want to get involved with your portfolio, you know, this is something to look at. But most people don't have 100 G's just laying around, and they can't pay, you know, the 15 grand, so they get into the judicial foreclosure program, which is a little bit quicker. It's more like quarterly than 12 to 24 months. But either way, we've got protocols and classes and coaching set up to guide you through all this. You can't do this by yourself. It's way too much information. Somebody wants to say, well, Dr. Anderson, why do we gotta pay you 5 G's for this? This is what we do. Every day we get up, this is what we do. We have relationships with the judges. I just showed y'all that we set aside mortgages. We know how to quiet title. We know how to file this paperwork. Somebody might get smart and say, oh, we seen you on YouTube. We're gonna go down the courthouse steps and do the same thing we do. Good luck. Get in and out of Judge Newkirk's chamber and trying to figure out what your instrument is, right? So sometimes in life, when you see somebody doing something, it's a lot easier to partner with them with their expertise than to try to go and do it yourself. And you don't have the 10, 20 years of experience, all the relationships, all the know-how, all the ability to do it. So I get this all the time. People say, oh, I want to do what you do. That's fine. If you want to do what we do, it's not going to happen in a weekend. Commit to the information. Partner up. You invest your money, I got to answer your calls. I got to walk you through the process. And hopefully you'll learn something. All right? But this is what we're about. Creating generational wealth is priceless. All right? I'm not going to get rich quick stuff. I just got back from Egypt. I'm like getting ready to go to the Dominican Republic on Tuesday, and I got like 75 other speaking engagements lined up for the rest of the year. I'm good. My goal right now in life is to make sure other people are good. I'm tired of people calling me, asking me for money. I'm tired of people, when I tell them, no, I'm not doing that, they get mad. I'm like, no, you can do the same thing that we're doing. Why are you mad that we are here and we move, right? It's offensive to other people who are broke. That's a broke mentality. That's something that they decided to own. And I'm gonna speak to them. We speak against them. So if you want to build wealth, you know, you can give us a call. Here's my information. My office is in the Highlands. All right, I'm downtown on Boulevard, Main Street. And I'm accessible. You can talk to Glenn. I think Glenn's coming to the class at the end of the month. And like I said, this is a brother that I have a lot of respect for. I mean, we've all kind of watched each other grow up over these past 10 years and see the success and be able to celebrate the success of each other in their own right. 10 years ago, man, this wasn't our situation. We was all hungry, looking for opportunity. Different things were happening, and we had to make some decisions. And we all been able to survive because of our commitment to the finance game. So I'm gonna say this in closing: it doesn't matter who you are, what color you are. None of that matters, man. This is a game about information. You can scream racism and white supremacy until you blue in the face. That person is going to jail because they chose to do something or they have limited information they didn't know, period. And when we get down to the mechanics on that, is that a factor that needs to be acknowledged? It is, but it's not an excuse.